This presentation considers a closed conducting loop carrying a current I. We determine the magnetic potential and field due to it at a point quite distant from the loop. It is found that the shape or the geometry of the loop has no effect on the values of the potential and field at very large distances from the loop. Consider a closed conducting loop in the XY plane encircling the origin with a steady current I flowing through it. To find the magnetic field at distant points like P, we simplify the diagram and we assume that P is located in the YZ plane. We assume that the distance between the loop and the point of determination is much larger than the dimensions of the loop. The magnetic vector potential at P will not have a Y component because contributions from opposite sides cancel out. There is no Z component because the path itself has no Z component. So A is 0, Y1, Z1, where 0, Y1, Z1 are the coordinates of the point P, is given by mu 0 I upon 4 pi closed integral dl2 upon r12. We consider the variation of r12 as we go around the loop. r12 is approximately equal to r1 minus y2 sine theta. So r1 square is equal to y1 square plus z1 square. A is equal to ax unit vector x, where ax is equal to mu 0 I upon 4 pi unit vector x integral dx2 upon r12. 1 upon r12 is approximately equal to 1 upon r1 minus y2 sin theta, which is equal to 1 upon r1 1 upon 1 minus y2 upon r1 sin theta, which is equal to 1 upon r1 1 minus y2 upon r1 sin theta raised to the power minus 1. Expanding binomially, we will get this equal to 1 upon r1 1 plus y2 upon r1 sin theta plus higher order terms, which are neglected. So as a result, we just have 1 upon r1 1 plus y2 upon r1 sin theta. So ax unit vector x 0 y1 z1 is given by unit vector x mu 0 I upon 4 pi closed integral dx2 upon r1 within brackets 1 plus y2 upon r1 sin theta, where r1 and theta are constants. Now closed integral dx2 is equal to 0. Closed integral y2 dx2 is equal to area of the loop regardless of the shape. Hence ax unit vector x 0 y1 z1 is equal to unit vector x mu 0 I sin theta upon 4 pi r1 square into area of the loop. Simple but crucial point: since the shape of the loop has not mattered, our restriction of P to the yz plane cannot make any difference to the final result. Therefore, the vector potential of a current loop of any shape at a distance r from the loop, which is much greater than the size of the loop, is a vector perpendicular to the plane containing r and normal to the plane of the loop, and is of magnitude A is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi Ia sin theta upon r square. Symmetry of A and B. This vector potential is symmetric around the axis of the loop. Hence, B is also symmetric around the axis of the current loop. This is so because we are considering regions so far from the loop that the details of the shape of the loop have a negligible influence. All loops with the same current into area product produce the same magnetic field far away. The product IA is known as the magnetic dipole moment of the current loop, and it is denoted by M vector. The magnetic dipole moment is a vector. Its direction is normal to the loop or normal to the area A defined by the loop. The direction of M is given by the right hand screw rule. Hence, the vector potential for the field of the magnetic dipole M is written as A is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi M cross R upon R cubed, where R is the radius vector in the direction from the loop to the point of determination. Direction of A must always be that of the current in the nearest part of the loop. Let's consider the components of the vector potential. This figure shows a magnetic dipole located at the origin with the dipole moment vector pointing in the positive z direction. To express the vector potential at any point, we can observe that r is equal to x square plus y square plus z square. Sine theta is equal to under root of x square plus y square upon r. Ax, Ay and Az. The magnitude of the vector potential is A is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi r square sine theta. A is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi m upon r square under root of x square plus y square upon r. A is tangent to a horizontal circle around the z axis as indicated in the figure. Ax is equal to A, close brackets, minus y upon under root x square plus y square, which is equal to minus mu 0 upon 4 pi my upon r cubed. Ay is equal to A into x upon under root x square plus y square, which is equal to mu 0 mx upon 4 pi r cubed, and Az is equal to 0. In order to evaluate B, we recall that B is equal to curl of A. So Bx is going to be equal to the xth component of curl of A, which is given by delta Az by delta y minus delta Ay by delta z, which is equal to 0 minus delta by delta z of mu 0 upon 4 pi mx upon r cubed, which is equal to minus mu 0 upon 4 pi mx minus 3 upon r to the power 4 delta r by delta z, which is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi mx 3 upon r to the power of 4 z upon r. We have done this differentiation a number of times, where r is given by under root of x square plus y square plus z square. Then delta r by delta z is simply z upon r, delta r by delta y is y upon r, and delta r by delta x is x upon r. Similarly, by will be equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi m 3yz upon r to the power of 5. But bz, which is given by the zth component of curl of A, is written as delta by delta x Ay minus delta by delta y Ax, which is equal to delta by delta x mu 0 upon 4 pi mx upon r cubed minus delta by delta y minus mu 0 upon 4 pi my upon r cubed. So we carry out the evaluation of B as follows. Continuing from the previous slide, we were on the xth components. So this is on the zth components. So this is mu 0 upon 4 pi delta by delta x mx upon r cubed plus delta by delta y my upon r cubed. Differentiation yields mu 0 upon 4 pi m upon r cubed minus 3mx upon r to the power 4 x by r plus m upon r cubed minus 3my upon r to the power 4 y upon r, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi 2 upon r cubed minus 3x square upon r to the power 5 minus 3y square upon r to the power of 5, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi 2 upon r cubed minus 3 x square plus y square upon r to the power of 5, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi 2 r square minus 3 x square plus y square upon r to the power of 5, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi 2 z square minus x square plus y square upon r to the power of 5. Since cos theta is equal to z upon r, sin theta is equal to root of x square plus y square upon r. So bx is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi m 3x upon r to the power of 4 cos theta, by is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi m 3y upon r to the power of 4 cos theta. Bx square plus by square will give us 3 mu 0 upon 4 pi r cubed m whole square cos square theta x square plus y square upon r square, which is 3 mu 0 upon 4 pi r cubed m whole square cos square theta sin square theta. So bz square is equal to mu 0 upon 4 pi r cubed m whole squared 2 cos square theta minus sin square theta whole square, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi r cubed whole square 3 cos square theta minus 1. The total resultant B is given by under root of bx square plus by square plus bz square, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi r cubed 3 cos square theta plus 1 raised to the power half, which is equal to mu 0 m upon 4 pi r cubed 3 cos square theta plus 1 raised to the power half. And if we compare it with E, E is given by 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught P upon r cubed 3 cos square theta plus 1 raised to the power of half. Between B and E, for B, the constant factor is mu 0 upon 4 pi. For E, the constant factor is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. For B, the magnetic dipole moment is M. For E, the electric dipole moment is P. But apart from that, their dependence on theta and r are the same. For B also, we have 3 cos square theta plus 1 raised to the power half. For E also, we have 3 cos square theta plus 1 raised to the power of half. And they have an inverse cubic dependence. This slide shows a comparison of the electric and magnetic dipoles. As you can see, for the electric dipole, the field lines start or originate at the positive charge and terminate at the negative charge. Whereas for a magnetic dipole, there is no such thing. The magnetic induction lines carry on and are continuous. They have no origin and end. At the bottom, the comparative expressions for the electric dipole and the magnetic dipole have been written. Whether we consider the magnetic field generated due to a magnet or we consider the magnetic field generated due to a current loop, we can see that the magnetic lines of force or the magnetic lines of induction are continuous in nature, whereas for an electric dipole, the lines of force originate at the positive charge and terminate at the negative charge.